And now it is my joy to announce to the audience that she is the proud mother of two of our own Stella Marians, Sunita and Vinita of the Commerce Department Shift 1. So we are very happy to have you, not just as Ms. Jeyasree Ravi, but also as a proud mother of our alumni. So now may I invite you, ma'am, to address the gathering. Can we welcome her with a big round of applause? She has done Chennai very proud.
Thank you so much for the very kind words, which makes me all the more nervous. So it's a great honor to be here to address this gathering. This is such a prestigious college, and it always brings back memories to me because, as she said, my daughters are alumni of this college, and I really need to thank the organizers, Fiki Flow Chennai and Thai Chennai, and the faculty of Stella Maris. And I should say, very proudly say that I'm a member of Fiki Flow too. So, coming straight to the point, how many of you would prefer not to join your family business given a choice? Can you put up your hands? Yes, yes. There are a few. Right, right. not to join the family. Right. So, many of us have this question in us. Is it an intelligent choice for a young graduate to pursue or to even be absorbed in the family business? Because then the question comes, what happens to your interests and your passion, and what about the adrenaline in seeking and finding yourself, in going for it all by yourself? But at the end of this 20 minutes, if I'm able to change the mindset of even three of you who put up your hands, I would say it's a very special day for me. I founded Palam in 2003. That was 15 years after I completed my college. And what took me so long? Same old story. Marriage, children, and then as the children grew up, I wanted to find a little more meaning to my life. One lucky thing for me was I got married into a family that was also in the same business as my father, so I could keep myself abreast of things. I was also very interested in marketing, so I used to pile up my library with so many marketing books. That was my own way of keeping myself motivated and updated. But I never dreamt that I would have a brand, a silk brand of my own. That was never on the agenda. It just dawned on me one fine day. I have two daughters and a son. So I just realized that it will only be my son who is going to inherit the family business. So I wanted to do something for my daughters, something small and manageable, something that I could, you know, carry on, handle on my own, and then pass it on to them. And I found out that I was comfortable only dealing with one thing, dealing with sarees. So I started off by supplying some pattu sarees to online portals. And then I ended up with a small retail store of my own. And it all happened too soon. And suddenly, I realized that I had a passion for silk. And it awakened in me something that I had felt as a small girl, as a kid, as a teenager. Silk was something that I connected to. I felt a kind of belonging. And now my house, that is my father's house, is just above the Nalli store. Even today, there is a Panangal Park Nalli, and the first floor is where my father and mother live. So those days I used to run and sit in my father's office, which was down there in the ground floor. Even today he sits there, one small room on the right side. So whenever I could escape my mother's vigilance, I will run down and sit there. So suddenly I could feel a passion for that brand, Nalli brand. And I think that pride just stuck with me as I grew. And I could suddenly feel all of this when I stepped into retail, when I started interacting with all my customers. It was like tapping something that had been lying dormant in me all these years. Who would imagine that I would find my the one passion 15-16 years after I had completed my college. So I think that's the magic of family business. The genes lie within you, somewhere deep within you, maybe hidden, and all it needs is one little spark. And now for me, when this happened, I began to work at Palam. It was almost like I had found one long lost friend in it. So initially I had started the business so that I wanted to find a way, somewhere I could find some kind of financial support for my daughters as they grew up. But all that was lost in this newly found passion. And I was working as if I was the only savior of silk. Because, see, those days, there was a slight change and people were beginning to wear the embroidered chiffons and georgettes even for the wedding reception. So I wanted to experiment with silk. I wanted to bring about a change. I wanted to modernize silk. And I was, as Ms. Agnes said, I was experimenting with, I had crazy concepts like Slimfit Pattu, Corporate Pattu, I had tattoo silk. I even went to the extent of changing the very texture of Kanchipurams. I wanted to make it, or I made it rather soft and light and easy to drape so more youngsters would wear silk. Now, my daughter, she even asks me, often she'll ask me, Ma, when Dad got married to you, did he know you were clinically crazy? But I think I am crazy when it comes to pattu sarees. And I feel that's the magic of family business. That's what family business does to you. There will be the genes in you, latent and hidden, and all it needs is a little stimulation for it to emerge out. Now, what gave me the guts to do all this, to make all, to bring about all these changes? Or how did people even accept it? How was it not regarded as it is almost, sometimes they may think, what audacity to bring about all these changes in Kanchipurams. But they did accept. So how was that? That's again the power of family business, the mother brand Nalli. Now, Palam is not my family business because it was a brand new venture that I had started and I am the founder. Even in a recent Fiki event in which I was a panelist, I was asked a question. Did I ever feel bad about not being offered to be a part of Nalli? Or did I ever dream to be a part of the family business? Of course I did. See, when I was a child, Nalli was the only silk brand. Even Kumaran Silks, I think it came much later, 1977 or 78. So I felt a connect to my father's business and to that brand Nalli. I feel my loyalty still lies with it. It's true to this day. And I always felt my dad was doing something awesome. And I felt it is the inspiration that I draw from him. Even makes me do what I do at Palam now. Just that I had a different perspective. I wanted to make silk, lighter, softer, so that more youngsters would wear it. But I think all of that I was able to do because I was my own boss there. It was my own brand. I could build my own identity. So Palam Silks, is it my family business? Yes and no. It is my family business because it is silk retail. It is not my family business because it's not the brand Nalli. My daughters also ask me, how did you think that you'll ever succeed? What made you think you'll succeed? Because you started, I was already 37 years old when I started all this. Probably I didn't know that a woman cannot start a sari retail business on her own in a conservative family. No one told me that. Or when a few of them did tell me, I didn't listen to them because I knew very well they were not my well-wishers. But on hindsight, now I feel that I have been able to do what I do there. I have been able to bring about all these changes, though I have a different perspective of silk, because people accepted me and my innovations. And how did that happen? Because Palam is born out of Nalli blood. A rose by any other name smells as sweet. this was my first tagline for Palam. So I think that's the power of family business. But yet, it looks like some of us are not very comfortable to pursue family business at all. So why is that? There are certain issues, true issues with regard to identity, freedom of execution. Maybe you don't know how to deal with it when your elders are very dominating you at the workplace. Maybe there's a difference of opinion, or you feel you don't have the skill set that is required to run the business. Maybe you feel very restricted, imprisoned. Maybe you feel you can do much more than this. Also, the business doesn't grow as fast as the family grows. Or you just want an adventure, the adventure of having a startup of your own. Now, what makes you think that only a startup is the toughest challenge? I think any business is an adventure. And of course, when it comes to family business is already there. The launchpad is already there. So that's an advantage. But even then, any business is an adventure because you never know what's in store for you that day. See, the last 20 years, so many changes have happened. Take marketing, right from word of mouth marketing. Today there is social media marketing, there's Facebook, there's Instagram. Running an existing business can never be close to monotony. Now, I would say family business is more like an arranged marriage. You get married and then you learn to love your spouse. So during my days, whether we liked it or not, somehow we tried to make things work. But today, breakups are becoming so, so common. So maybe now the onus lies on the elders to lure you into the family business. But then, trust me, it is not a trap. It can be more addictive than your smartphones. There will be a point of time when you will not know where you end and where your business begins. And I'm telling you this because I have two daughters and I have had this discussion with them 5 years ago. Now let's come to other practical issues. Say your father is a very strict disciplinarian, and already on a normal day you try to be away from home to escape his presence, and now if you're in family business you have to be with him 24 hours at work and at home. But I would tell you, please don't step back from family business. You be punctual, you be consistent, you meet your deadlines. I'm sure your father would respect you for that, would be able to respect you as a co-worker if you make it a point to start from round one, from the desk and not the cabin. And then you will have to show him that you will make a difference in the business, that you will earn your rightful position in the company. You will have to understand they are not always wrong and you are not always right. Listen to them when they have something to say. Listen and learn the nuances of the business. I think they are the best teachers, even better than some teachers in the top B schools. So give them due respect and learn from their experiences. Now there is one more issue that most of you are not even openly expressing. It is said from a study that non-verbal communication makes for 80% of the actual communication. So this issue is something like that, something similar to social stigma. If I take up my family business, does that mean that I don't have enough stuff to establish myself independently? Say you finished your college, you finish your degree and you join your family business. Yes, there will be some people who may think that maybe she didn't get a good job. Maybe she doesn't have any new business idea. Maybe she doesn't have the guts to start something on her own. Maybe she doesn't have the stomach to take the risks. People will judge. Rather, people will always judge. Now, if you're going to make your decision just for the sake of these few people who are judging you, then you need to think twice. You need to think, is it worth it? Do you really need to give so much importance to these few people who are judging about you, who will not even raise a finger to help you in what you do, who prefer to just gossip about what you can do with your life? See, your decision should be based on what you want. It should be based on you. It should be everything about you. You don't like to join the family business? Fine. Even then, I would say, if you are good at the numbers, then you should run the show with a good showman. You can do it. You can invest and work from behind the scenes. You can sponsor the show, and the show can still go on if you so choose. There is a common saying, everyone will say this. See, family is different, business is different. You also may have seen in so many families that there are some issues that arise and the families fall apart because of the business. And you don't want such things to happen to you. True, very true. I completely agree, because even I have witnessed all this. There will be issues between the siblings, and then one stabbing the other in the back. It happens. Now, when I was a child, I never used to talk to any strangers. I won't even talking to the guests who come home. That will be one big ordeal for me. But today, my grandnephew, he's a small kid, Skanda, 5-6 years old. He opens the front door for the guests and he'll tell you, "Oh, it's you. Okay, my mom and all the other ladies are sitting in the second floor. Come, I'll take you up." So, families did have issues because they were not openly discussing it. Things that should have been nipped in the bud was allowed to grow into, I would say, marshy swamps. But you youngsters, you are all so friendly. You are all so expressive. Unlike how we used to be in those days. So I think it will not be a problem for you. You know where to draw the line. And the worst case, you will know how to part as friends. See, even in my house, a lot of discussions will happen about business between me and my two daughters. When all of us are in a mood to discuss, suddenly when I start talking, in 2 minutes we'll all be sitting there, but I'll get one WhatsApp message. "Ma, I think we should be discussing this tomorrow at the store." Or I'll get a message saying, "No, I'm not in the mood to discuss this now. Can we stop?" I respect that. I totally respect that. But it is this business that brings us together, that keeps us, that bond together. And I think, see, my daughters are smart. They work on their strengths and they respect each other's space. In fact, it was they who came and told me that they would like to split the responsibilities among themselves. So they know what they are doing. I need to be around only to guide them and maybe to make some major decisions for them, because for that they may take a few more years. But family business can be easier, it can be simpler, and can be a lot of fun if you are really open and expressive about it. Now, I told you I have a son too. So my son, he completed his college in 2016 March, and I was mentally prepared. Okay, now he's going to take 1 or 2 years even before he decides what to do further. But he surprised me when he came to me just 2 months later and he said that he wants to join Sri Kumaran Stores, that is his father's business, family business on my husband's side. I was really surprised. I know for one that he is not passionate about his work, but he believes that it is his birthright to be there, and he just wants it. But his passion is fitness. So I strongly believe that he will find a way in the days to come to accommodate both the family business and his passion, but only time can tell. So problems, there will always be problems. You need to deal with them, you need to solve them. Running away from the problem is not, should not be your choice. In fact, you should stand up and fight for that smooth working atmosphere in your family business if that is your problem. Be patient, contribute, keep contributing, and recognition that will come to you with time. Make yourself indispensable. Make yourself indispensable by doing a little more in everything, every day. As you make yourself indispensable, you'll find that people, that your parents or your father or uncle, whoever it is, he respects you. Your suggestions will be heard, and you will see that it's not so difficult to implement all the changes that you want in that business to bring about that growth, to make it survive. Say you just don't find your connect with this business at all. It is just not your cup of tea. Even then, I would say, please hold on to your share. See if you can bring an outsider to run this business. See, you may have hundreds of reasons, but are they enough for you to abandon your family business? You must be in it in spite of all these issues. Why? India is a free country. Just see, think, if we had to abuse our freedom, then the lives of all those people who, you know, the people who lost their lives in the struggle for independence, all that becomes meaningless. But they would have had a dream for the country. They would have had a vision for India. So also, your grandfather or great-grandfather, or for that matter, your father or uncles, they all must have slogged for this business in the initial years. And for all that, they would have known that they will not be around to enjoy the fruits. Still, they would have relentlessly worked at it just because it would benefit the generations to come. Only the person who founded the business, only the founder, only the person who built it brick by brick will know the value. Say you have your own dreams, you want to do your own thing, fine. Go ahead, do it. But still, spare some time for this family business. Employ the right people, have the right people doing the right things in the business. Have a financial advisor who would be able to see that the business is financially healthy and viable. Your forefathers must have put in so much work. Let all that not go meaningless. See, only in rare cases, family business has to be shut down because it's outdated. Say, you were in the manufacture of audio cassettes or VHS tape. But that's a very rare case. You need to do your bit to keep this family business alive. Who knows? The genes that are dormant in you, those same genes may be very strong and very active in your own son or daughter or grandchild. He may find his passion in it. My father, he is 79 years old. He is still at the helm of affairs. He sits in the shop, the main nulli at Panagal Park. And my brother, he heads all the branches all over India and abroad. Now, his daughter, Lavanya, she heads the operations. So, there is no issue with regard to identity. Identity is all about how much you contribute to the family business. Now, at Palam, Vinita, she's my second daughter, she is very much involved in the operations. And my elder daughter, Sunita, she is a chartered accountant. She heads the design section at Palam. She's also, she does interior styling. She has a label of her own, Sunita Yogesh, and she does furnishings. Now, I have to be a little flexible with her. I cannot expect Palam to be everything for her. I need to be flexible. I need to give her the space to allow her to pursue her dreams. And still, she should be able to give me a helping hand at Palam. And she is also able to find time for all of this. See, the business is bigger and mightier than you. If you contribute to its growth you're going to feel secure. Now you will feel good if you focus on what you do for the business and not focusing on what the business is doing for you. You need to contribute your time. You need to do focus on what you can do for, say, that the everyday operations or whatever you can do for that business. You need to take pride in seeing that the business is up and running. You need to take pride in making the business survive. You need to take pride in being able to pass it on to your next generation. See, in handloom, we have a completely different issue. Now, weaving is almost considered as manual labor. So, the next generation is moving away to other industries, and parents are also not willing to teach the art of weaving to their children. So, to make this art live on, for the art to survive, now we are looking at ways if we can mechanize the looms, mechanize the pedals portion so that it still remains hand loom, so that the art will still live on. If we value family business, if we do something for the family business to survive, then actually so many treasures of the country would have lived on. You need to understand the power of family business. You need to give it due respect. You need to contribute your time. Now, your forefathers, they have sown the seeds, knowing very well that they will not be able to enjoy the fruits. Now the trees are all fully grown and the roots can grow and find the water by itself. But you will still need to be around, maybe to spray the pesticide, protect it from the pest, to trim the trees, trim all the branches. And you will also need to plant your own trees and understand you will not be around to enjoy the fruits of that. When it comes to working with family, we have one more assumption. You presume that your family knows you inside out. You don't expect, please don't expect them to be masters at mind reading. If you need more freedom in the business, please tell them so. If you think this family business is not everything to you, it's only a kind of, say, you can work at it only like a part-time job, tell them so. It's up to them to see how to accommodate to your working styles. They need to be flexible, no doubt, but for that you need to be open, and you need to be, you need to express what you expect from that business. You may still wonder, how do I care? It is someone else's dream. I don't even know the founder of this business. To me, he's just a picture on that wall. I don't feel any chemistry. How do you think I can do justice to it? Or you may argue, even I have a dream. I want to do things on my own just like he did. I want to lay the foundation and I want to pass it on to the next gen. I want my children and grandchildren to feel proud of me. Just think, you are not comfortable, you don't like it when things are handed down to you on a silver platter. You feel like a loser. But even when it comes to you, you will want to pass it on only to your own bloodline. Only then you'll feel good about it. Only then you'll feel complete. Thank you.
We will now open the floor for questions. We have room for two questions, so do any of you have questions?
Ma'am, in those days, like, women had so many barriers to become entrepreneurs. But these days we have equal opportunities, but then women are still hesitant or reluctant to become entrepreneurs. What do you think is the recent challenges they are facing to become entrepreneurs?
I think the main challenge would be, one is you need a kind of financial expertise. Definitely, because any business is for profits. What happens is, I think when it comes to women, we have the talents. You think you can convert that into a business, but how to make it into a profitable business is what becomes a question. So you need to have a financial advisor with you right from scratch. That will really help you to implement and, you know, to bring to reality whatever your dreams are, because financially it has to be viable. That's the main thing.
So women nowadays prefer go for modern dresses. So what is the future for sari?
Okay. I think you would have even seen the 100-day sari pact. So I think sarees are coming back. It all depends on how we portray it. Again, it's a kind of marketing, but it is not like advertisement. We need to do what we need to understand what, suppose I need to want you to wear a saree. I need to understand what kind of a saree that you would wear and what are the occasions that you would prefer to wear. In fact, bringing corporate pattu was for that reason, because people do wear sarees at executive meetings, but they were not wearing pattu sarees because it was all very heavy and very traditional and with zari. So we need to come up with ways to see what kind of design will make you want to wear a saree.
Thank you.
We will now wrap up this session. I would like to render my profound gratitude to Ms. Jeyasree Ravi, the co-founder of Palam Silks. Thank you, ma'am, for sharing your success story with us. I'm sure most of us would have already drawn inspiration from it. As a token of our love and appreciation, I request Dr. Shanti Stanley to felicitate our speaker, Ms. Jeyasree Ravi.